Street Talk, another stop, Mike, Mad Dog, Magnotti. Hey, it is the first show for 2021. And I hope that 2020 didn't let the door slam it in the ass as it walked out the door. But hey, new chance, new start, new hope. Okay, it's a new year, folks. But hey, got a good show for you today. But just a couple of things. I was listening, I was out and I heard two old ladies talking the other day. And one of them said, my grandkids love me so much and they're so good at social distancing. They don't even call me. And you know, the washing your hand, this nonsense, and they say you're supposed to sing happy birthday while you wash your hands, and that gives you the right amount of time. I don't know who came up with that idea, but every time I walk out of the bathroom now, my kids expect me to be holding a cake. Okay, well, hey, we got a good show. I got a Mr. Dave Williams on today. Dave is an educator with the Wenatchee School District. He's been teaching for 3 decades. I know him through music theater. He's a very, very accomplished actor, musician. If you've ever been to a music theater production, you've probably seen him one time or another. But I wanted to talk to him about his job as an educator and how it's been affected with this pandemic. But hey, Street Talk and other stuff. Mike, Mad Dog, Magnotti, you stick around. We will be right back.
CVCH wants to make your winter just a little brighter with their Get Out and Explore gift giveaway. This December and January, visit cvchgetout.com and download fun, safe, and simple activity guides to 4 beautiful towns in our backyard: Wenatchee, Chelan, Cashmere, and Leavenworth. Most activities are free of charge and unique to the community you visit. So get out and explore. Visit cvchgetout.com for details.
Street talking other stuff. We're back. And as I said, I'm talking with Mr. Dave Williams. Dave, how are you, buddy?
I'm doing well. How are you doing?
I'm doing great. You know, I mentioned earlier today that I'm not a joiner, but I've joined 3 things in my life that I'm proud of. New Song Community Church is one, Wenatchee Police Guild is another, and Music Theater of Wenatchee is the third. And the reason being, it's people like you that have made this organization, Music Theater of Wenatchee, such a great organization. And it's just, you know, proud to be a part of it, proud to be your pal, and proud to have been associated with you, you know?
Thank you, Mike. I feel the same about you.
Oh, I appreciate that. Okay. But look, okay, tell us a little bit about yourself, just personally, you know, family, that type of thing. And we'll get into the Music Theater stuff, teaching, and the issue why I have you on here about being an educator in the COVID days. So,
well, I was born in Wenatchee, born and raised in Wenatchee. I had a challenging upbringing.
Yeah, like many of us, so.
Yeah. There was some mental illness and some alcoholism in my family. And mm-hmm. But I still love my parents, and I knew that they love me. And sure. I remember you having to come to my house a few times and deal with some interesting domestic situations. So
yeah, met your mom and dad.
We've known each other for a long time.
But so, hey, Dave, look, you know, it could have been my house too, buddy.
Yeah, that's true.
I mean, there were times, you know, I don't, your house may not have been like this, but there were a number of times we fled our house because of domestic situations, and we got farmed out to live with other people. And yeah, hey, we all got stories, dude. So, you know,
and it just shows that, you know, there, we can overcome, you know,
difficult situations. Exactly. Big time.
And I also, when I was growing up, I had a second family named the Bush family, and Ray and Buzz Bush, who were fixtures of this community. And my best friend, Greg, that I met in third grade, and we've remained best friends ever since.
Oh, cool. Yeah.
Still lives in Wenatchee with his family. And, you know, just growing up and dealing with some of that, what helped me survive and deal was music and drama,
sure.
Especially in high school. And I became totally immersed in that. And, you know, music theater, Wenatchee, even when I was a teenager, I had my first starring role in Damn Yankees. I don't know if you knew that.
Who directed? Okay, I want to tell you one thing. Stop shaking your table. It's making your computer shake.
Oh, so sorry.
Okay, sorry. You're making me seasick.
All right, let me back up a little bit.
Okay, who directed Damn Yankees when you were in it?
That was Pam Cole.
Oh, I was in that.
Oh, you were? And you don't even remember me. Well, that's good.
It's a long story that you don't want me to get into, okay?
Oh, okay.
Now, I love Pam to death, but I did not want to be in that show. But we'll talk about that another time, okay?
You were forced to be in it?
Pam said, Mike, I'm desperate. And I love Pam.
Yeah, yeah.
So I said, okay. But so,
yeah.
Yeah, who'd you play?
I was Young Joe from Hannibal Mo.
That's right. That's right. I remember.
Yeah.
But okay, all right. But that was your first big role for music theater?
That was my first big role. I mean, I had high school roles as well. And I played Marcellus Washburn in The Music Man in high school.
All right. Under the
direction of Dan Jackson and Sue Lawson.
Yeah.
And actually, if you're familiar with that show, Buddy Hackett played Marcellus Washburn in the movie version.
Yeah.
And it was meant to be kind of funny with his weight and everything. And I was the opposite. I was probably about 120 pounds. So I was a stick. So that was the comedy relief.
Yeah. Well, I tell people never to watch the movie of whatever show we're doing, because I don't want them trying to repeat the characters. You know, I want
exactly.
them to make their own. So.
Yeah. And, you know, several years ago when we came back to Wenatchee, I also got to play Harold Hill up in Leavenworth. So it was kind of fun to, you know, play both of those roles.
Oh, cool. Good.
But I went through the Wenatchee schools. I went to Sunny Slope Elementary for K through two, Columbia Elementary when it was a three-story building.
I don't remember that.
Yeah, with no screens or anything on the windows, and you'd open them up. We could probably have just jumped if we wanted to. Then Pioneer, which pretty much looks the same. In fact, that sign, that wooden sign out there, is one that was made, I think, when I left.
Really?
The high school, yeah. So, and I graduated from the high school in 1984. And it looks very similar. I think some of the carpets are still there. And then I went to WVC and got my associate in arts and sciences and graduated from there, and then went to Central, got my teaching degree, a minor in music. And that's where, you know, I met my wife, Diana. She was also going through the education program. So we got married. Our first jobs were in West Valley, Yakima.
Oh, okay. All right.
Yeah. And I actually taught music and fine arts for 2 years.
Yeah.
And then moved on to the regular classroom, elementary, third grade, second grade.
Well, what was it that made you want to go into education? What was it that prompted you to get into that?
I always, when I was younger, I was always wanting to be either a professional actor or an educator. And I know that sounds weird, but probably when I was about 8 to 12 years old, I used to play teacher with my cousins and friends and whatnot. And I was the teacher. And of course they were the students. And I don't know why, but it was just, you know, something I like to do. And then when I got in high school, Dan Jackson, who was amazing choir director and teacher at the high school.
A great man.
Yes. And he really believed in my talents. And it was the first time that I actually began believing in myself.
Yeah. Good. Cool. Yeah.
And another terrific influence was English teacher Gail Northcutt. I don't know if you know who she is.
No, did not, no.
Yeah, and she knew a lot about my struggles at home, and but she encouraged me in my writing. She helped me build a foundation in English and writing and whatnot, and both of them are retired now, and so they were big influences. And then when I went to WVC, Dick Lapo really helped me grow as a musician, and he also helped me apply for scholarships, and that I used at Central Washington University. And so he was a great influence as well.
Well, you know, it's interesting. A lot of people in the helping professions, such as education, police work, medicine, came from troubled childhoods. You know, the theory is that we grow up not wanting or more like it, wanting to be able to help people in similar situations and hopefully prevent that in others, you know. And you know, that's a situation you and I did. I mean, we stopped it. I mean, I don't know how you and Diana address these issues, and I don't know what her childhood was like, but we, you know, Rosie and I spent hours talking about what our childhoods were like and what we were going to do differently. And, you know, the cycles of, you know, domestic issues just stopped with us on our side.
And definitely. And I was the first person in my family to go to college.
Yeah, good for you.
You know, I kind of wanted to escape from Wenatchee at the time because of the home life, and moving on to Central was just a real godsend.
Yeah. What made you want to come back? Okay. I mean, because I love it here.
You know? Well, I'll, I don't know if you remember, but I used to work at KPQ Radio, and there was a little jingle that we would play sometimes that would come on. It was, "Born and raised in Wenatchee, drifted to LA, spent my year just dreaming about my city far away. I'm coming home, Wenatchee, I'm coming home to stay." And I went 560 KPQ. Yeah. And I was thinking, you know, I just like a lot of other people, I was excited to move away from the Valley. Oh, right, it's going to be much better, you know. And when we first moved to Yakima, that city wasn't...
Yakima's not much better. I mean, come on, you know.
Yes, it was definitely not the Palm Springs of Washington. My kids were all born there. So, yeah. You know, I have good memories. But,
yeah, sure.
And then we moved to Southern California in 2000.
Oh, I didn't know that. Okay.
Yeah, my wife's parents lived in San Diego, well, North County, San Diego. And so we decided we wanted to move down there. So my wife and I both had teaching jobs down there. And I loved San Diego. Actually, it was in Temecula, which is northern. The weather was beautiful.
Yeah, it's a pretty town.
Yeah, and we had five swimming pools to choose from in our community. I mean, it was amazing, palm trees everywhere. But the one thing that was really different was you couldn't get to know people.
Interesting.
Yeah, most of them spent hours a day on the freeway commuting, and you couldn't even get to know your own neighbors. And I just kept telling my wife, you know, I don't want to grow old and die here. It doesn't feel like home.
Right.
And I always thought, you know, my kids can move 15 miles away and it would take 2 hours to get to their house.
Sure.
So yeah. I just said, let's try moving back to Wenatchee.
Okay.
And
but you were teaching then when you were in Southern California, right?
Oh yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, we both taught in Southern California for 5 years, and my wife taught at a charter school at the time, taught Spanish, and I continued teaching third grade. But we decided we wanted to take a flight up to Wenatchee. So we got on, you know, the plane. And as we were coming into Wenatchee, well, over the Cascades, we realized we were sitting next to the human services director.
Oh, okay. All right. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. At the school district.
Okay.
And so she was asking us, what do you do? And we just told her, and we told her how we were looking at the possibility of moving to Wenatchee and teaching. Oh my gosh, it was just like the door opened.
Oh wow, cool.
Yeah. And so we came here, we were just looking at houses just for fun. We didn't really know what was going to happen. But then as soon as we went back to California, we put our house up for sale. We actually sold our house before we even had jobs. And a realtor that we know here looked for a house for us while we were down there. We didn't even go and see the house in person.
Yeah.
We bought the house by just seeing it over the internet. Really? Yeah.
Well, you're a braver man than me.
And we have a great house. So that was awesome.
And Diana was okay with that?
Oh, yeah. In fact, she loves it here.
Yeah. I mean, okay with buying a house sight unseen like that?
Well, yeah. I mean, we did kind of see it, you know. He gave us virtual tours and whatnot, and we had heard he was an amazing realtor, so yeah. we trusted him. And then, so when we came back, or when we came to move into our house, we both got jobs right away.
So where'd you start teaching? Where was your first job when you were here?
My first job back here was first grade at Mission View.
Okay. Mission View is the one that's in the south end of town, correct?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. Right. And first grade was a stretch for me. It was a little young, but I had an enjoyable year. It was just mm-hmm. different. And then from there, I started in 2006, seven. Okay. I started at Washington, and I've been there ever since, and I love Washington.
Okay, and what grades are you teaching now?
I teach third and have taught third for years and years. So.
Okay, all right.
I mean, I have taught other grades as well, but third mostly.
Okay. So. All right, and how about Diana? What does she teach?
Third. She teaches at Lincoln Elementary, but you know, she's before then she taught Spanish at the middle schools in Yakima and then again down in Southern California. So
okay, so you've always been elementary, younger on the elementary side, right?
Yeah.
Okay, you like that? Obviously you like that. So
I do. Yeah. I do. I mean, I had when I was younger, I had in my mind that I wanted to be a high school English teacher or a high school music teacher. And I think I would have been really good at teaching high school choir music.
Yeah, probably, yeah.
Yeah, I didn't have the piano skills. And you really do have to have some piano skills to teach. So.
Well, see, I had wanted to go into education myself, you know.
Oh, really?
Yeah, but I realized, you know, I wanted to teach history in high school, but I had to be honest. I said, you know, I don't think I could engage me if I walked into my classroom. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
A kid like me walking into the classroom, I don't think I would have had the talent to be able to engage that person. You know?
Yeah.
There's times I used to go to Pioneer School. They used to do a thing where people from the community would come in and read, you know. Mm-hmm. And there was a guy named Jim Briglub. He'd invite me every year, and I went to read in his class. And then another gal had the hard class. She had the class with all the misfits in it, so to speak.
Uh-oh.
The
difficult kids.
And I'd stop in there. And for half an hour, I mean, I can entertain these kids. You know, I had these kids going on World War II once. We're looking at a globe, and I'm explaining everything to them. But to do that day after day, I'm not the man you are. So,
well, I wasn't a perfect child at school either when I was going through middle school. I remember spraying Windex on one of my teacher's plants before she came into the classroom. I mean, I did things, put fake vomit into their desks and things like that.
So, all right, look, we got to take a break. We're street talking on the stuff. Mike Maddog, Magnotti, talking Mr. Dave Williams.
For all the latest news in North Central Washington, go to NCWLIFE.com or find us on Facebook. Got a news tip? Email us at news@NCWLIFE.com or call 888-2020.
All right, we're back. Street talking on the stuff. Mike Maddog, Magnotti, talking Mr. David Williams. He's a third grade teacher at Washington School. And David, you've been teaching how many years now total?
Oh my gosh, 30 years.
30, that really?
Yeah.
Oh man, I always think of you as a kid. Really, 30 years?
We're both old.
All right, but okay, COVID, okay? We're coming up on the year anniversary of when all this started. What has it been like for you as educators with this pandemic business? You know, I know what it's like for the kids because I got a couple, a grandson in elementary school and a granddaughter in middle school. So, but from your perspective, what's it been like?
Surreal. It's been completely surreal. I mean, it happened, I think it was last April that we, you know, were told that.
Just about.
Yeah, that schools were shutting down and trying to find, you know, how were we going to do this and try to meet the kids' needs and all this. And I think most schools were floundering as far as how do we address this.
Sure.
At the time, we decided to use Google Meet, which is kind of like Zoom, to talk to kids. But we didn't really have a educational plan mm-hmm. or teach you know, virtually. It was more like we would meet and talk, and a lot of social emotional issues we would deal with. And because there was a lot of anxiety and sure. anger with the kids. And then we did have a platform called Google Classroom where we would assign things, you know, and then I would get on there and say, oh, let's, you know, do this. But it was very surreal.
Yeah. You know? I mean, because this hit everybody unexpected. I mean, it wasn't exactly you were planning on. What do we do if suddenly schools are shut down, right?
Yeah, definitely.
So and what then, were the initial reactions? I mean, what were the initial steps everybody took when, you know, I remember when the governor got on and said, everything's closed down. I said, well, heaven's sakes, you're not going to lose any money. I'm going to work. You know, I mean, that was my emotional reaction.
Exactly.
You know, yeah. Somebody said, well, don't politicize it. And I said, I'm not, you know, I just, I mean, I got a living to make. And
yeah. Yeah. You know, the parents in my classroom were very supportive. They knew what we were going through as teachers, and they were, you know, they tried everything they could to help their child succeed. But, you know, they missed a huge chunk
sure.
of curriculum. You know, we were getting into deeper multiplication and division, which is a crucial skill in third grade. And
yeah, big time.
I could only do so much at that point because we just didn't know how to address something. So I'm sure that the kids, when they moved to fourth grade, some of them had some pretty big holes to fill academically.
All right, so what were the additional steps you guys took to start to address this?
Like in the fall, you mean?
Yeah.
Okay, well, that was
basically when it shut down, nobody was coming. You weren't doing any online.
Exactly. Yeah. And it was very strange to say goodbye to my class and online and, you know, it wasn't really an ending to a school year. When we started back in the fall, you know, we wanted to do more formal teaching, which was a challenge. We, as educators, had to learn how to use Canvas. And I remember I was so stressed. I was in tears.
Really?
Because I just couldn't figure out how to do that. And then, we were also meeting at the same time with the kids in the morning on Zoom just to do social emotional things.
Right.
Then at the same time, we were also meeting in person with the kids and their parents just for short in-person meetings.
Well, see, how many kids were you doing a Zoom meeting with?
23. Wow. Yeah.
Okay. And they all had to have their cameras on and everything and actually interact?
Initially, I had a few kids that would be resistant to turning on cameras.
Yeah.
And, you know, there are reasons why some kids might not want to turn on their cameras beyond just trying avoidance.
Yeah.
You know, you never know what's going to be going on in the house.
A lot of it's going to depend on, you know, the personality of the kid and how they engage with education. My granddaughter Maya is in seventh grade, I believe, and she is into it. You know, I mean, sometimes she spends her days over here and there's a sign on my door that says do not enter. She's over at the desk behind me. I mean, she's got the computer and she is into it.
That's awesome.
Then my grandson Luca is in fourth grade, I believe, and he's the type that they are actually doing homeschooling with him because he wouldn't do well interacting this way. I mean, he has a hard enough time interacting in class, and had I been there, I would have been the kid who sat there, you know, with his picture in front of the camera or something, pretending I was online while I was reading a book and not paying attention to the teacher. I mean, it's got to be really, really tough.
Yeah, and I, you know, I think about sometimes sitting in staff meetings just for an hour, I just about go Harry Carey. Yeah. So you can imagine sitting in front of a computer screen for three and a half hours. That's not an easy thing, especially for young kids. Well, I think all kids in general. So, you know, you get that fatigue going on and it's very hard to focus.
Okay, so like when Christmas break is over and you go back, what's it going to look like? What's going to happen?
Well, the week before Christmas break, we had the students come back in person. Okay. So I had
all time, all day.
Well, okay. So the class was divided in half. So I would have the morning and the afternoon groups, and it was very unusual because, you know, I had, of course, they were all spaced apart 6 feet.
Right.
They all were wearing their masks. I wore my mask.
Yeah.
They weren't really supposed to go anywhere else in the building except for during recess. They could go outside, but, and they had to stay in their cohort even when they were outside. So they were able to remove their mask when they went outside, but they still were, you know, told to keep their distance and then, you know, play with just the people in their cohort.
Okay, so how's that working?
You know, better than I anticipated.
Good.
I was just thinking, oh my gosh, it's going to feel like prison to the kids. But you know, younger kids are pretty resilient.
Yeah.
And when they came the first day, they were very excited, you know, just to even be back in the building and just see their friends in person rather than on the computer screen.
Yeah.
And to see me in person, I hope. So it was, and they didn't even complain about wearing their masks or anything. It just was what it was. So.
And you have a great reputation, you know, from what I've heard about other people, about how you do with the kids and everything, you're very highly thought of, you know.
That's pretty nice of you.
And I appreciate that because, you know, it's different than when I was a kid. I mean, my first grade class at Lincoln School in Caldwell, New Jersey, had like 42 kids in it.
Oh, you know? My God.
And it didn't get much better than that. And education, I mean, there's issues with it, certainly, but it was not the same. And it was tough. You know, by third grade, I was really, really disliking school. And a lot of that had to do with probably was the attitude of some of my teachers.
Yeah.
You know, I know a number of my teachers said, this is the worst class I ever had. And I always wanted to say to them, well, you're the worst teacher.
As teachers, we all have some classes that come through that are a little bit more challenging than others. Sure. Yeah.
But I appreciate the job you do. It's a great service, and I thank you for it. But look, we got to take a break, and we can come back and say goodbye, okay?
All right.
Okay, so street talking and other stuff. Mike, Mad Dog, Magnetti, stick around. We will be right back.
Hey, everyone. Fletcher and Amy Ellington here from Live It Up. Join us every week as we answer your questions on health, wealth, and relationships.
We're all about you creating a life that you love, so tune in to Live It Up.
Okay, we're back talking with Mr. Dave Williams, third grade teacher at Washington School. A good friend of mine, appreciate the relationship with him we have through music theater, and I'm glad to have this time to talk to you, Dave, about, you know, the work you do as an educator. But what's going to be the new normal? Just take another minute or so just to fill us in on it.
I think they'll continue with an online academy. The other thing is now all the kids have their own computers.
Yeah, right.
We didn't have that luxury before. And, you know, things are evolving big time in technology. And I think there's going to be jobs in the future that don't even exist today.
Well, that's true for our experience. So
yeah, exactly. And a lot of it is going to be built around technology. And, and you know, you have knowledge at your fingertips. So the teacher role, I think, is going to evolve as well to be more of, you know, understanding how to use tools, how to problem solve, but also just teaching social, emotional learning and how to relate to other people, how to communicate effectively. I mean, we see a little bit of that now, I think, in our society where,
yeah.
You know, some people struggle to effectively communicate, and employers definitely are looking for that piece. So
okay.
I think that's, yeah.
Well, I appreciate you being here, Dave. Thanks very much, okay?
You're very welcome.
Good luck back in the classroom. You do an important job. Okay, street talk and other stuff. Talk to Mr. Dave Williams. Dave, thank you, ladies and gentlemen. It's 2021, okay? We got a new start, so let's take advantage of it. Have a great year, Dave. Have a great day.
Thank you.
God bless you, everybody. Bye-bye.